Philippine Justice Secretary Boying Remulla faces growing calls for resignation following the arrest of his son over drug possession. But President Bongbong Marcos says the calls have no basis. The Philippine government bracing for the landfall of Tropical Depression Nenen. A business group calls on the Marcos administration to address the peso's further depreciation against the U.S. dollar. And the word war between the U.S. and Saudi Arabia escalates over the planned oil output cut of OPEC and its allies. Good afternoon, I'm Vaughn Crowe. You're watching Top Story. Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. shunning calls for Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla's resignation. There's been public clamor for Remulla to step down after his son was arrested for drug possession. But Marcos is defending the Justice Secretary.
I think the calls for him to resign have no basis. You call for somebody to resign if he's not doing his job or that they have misbehaved in that job. He has not done any of that. Quite the contrary, he has taken the very proper position that he is recusing himself from any involvement in the case of his son. And I think that he, being the Secretary of the Department of Justice, he is very, very aware that he must allow the processes of the judiciary to work properly and that no one in the executive should interfere.
The Justice Secretary's eldest son, Juanito Jose Diaz Remulla III, was nabbed earlier this week for possession of more than 1 million pesos worth of high-grade marijuana. In an interview with SMNI today, the Justice Chief says he serves at the pleasure of the President. In an earlier statement, meanwhile, Secretary Remulla said he will let justice take its own course. Vowing not to interfere in his son's case, Remulla said his son should face the consequences of his action. He also thanked authorities for doing their job without fear or favor. Other members of the Remulla family speaking out on the arrest of the Justice Secretary's son, Cavite Governor John Vic Remulla, who first confirmed the news about his nephew's arrest, vowed to stay away from the case and to not use his position to influence the outcome. Meanwhile, Gilbert Remulla, the director of the Philippine Amusement and Gaming Corporation, took to Twitter to say the situation is a cross that his family will bear. He also described drug addiction as a scourge that ruins lives and tears families apart. For former Justice Secretary Franklin Rilon, Remulla must prove to the public he will not intervene in his son's drug case. Rilon says Remulla should quit his post the moment he is perceived to side with his son.
There are rules governing prosecution of drug cases. And we should be honored. We should be followed. He can inhibit and let the matter of the appeal be decided by the chief state prosecutor. The chief state prosecutor, especially today, is a career person, mm-hmm. and is not an appointee of Secretary Remulla. I have confidence in the bureaucracy of the Department of Justice that they will not allow they will not allow that they be influenced by the Secretary of Justice.
Meanwhile, some lawyers are also backing calls for Secretary Remulla's resignation to avoid a possible conflict of interest.
Meron tayong sa kultura natin yung delikadeza. Kasi sa delikadeza, ibig sabihin nun, palagay mo, meron kang kumbaga, hindi ka na angkop dun sa posisyon, hindi ka na angkop dun sa sitwasyon. Una, sa bahagi ni Secretary Remulla, ang magiging usapin dito ay conflict of interest dahil siya ay ang Secretary of Justice, siya ang pinakapinuno ng lahat ng prosecutor sa Pilipinas. Kaya ang magpo-prosecute o yung abogadong magkakaso tungkol dito ay galing sa DOJ at siya ang chief.
For a House lawmaker, calls for Secretary Remulla's resignation are unfair. Robert Barbers, the chairperson of the House Committee on Dangerous Drugs, says the arrest of Remulla's son does not warrant a resignation.
He's doing his job efficiently. He's doing everything he can to improve the justice system in the country. So I think it's just too unfair for someone to demand for that.
The Bureau of Customs set to coordinate with their U.S. counterparts to trace the source of the drug parcel seized from Justice Secretary Remulla's son. The agency says the parcels from San Diego, California, arrived in the Philippines on September 27 and was picked up on October 11. The BOC adds from July to September, they have conducted around 13 drug busts with the Philippine Drug Enforcement Agency. Some of the illegal drugs came from the U.S., Laos, and Myanmar.
Upon arrival po, ang parcel po ay nasasubject sa x-ray and physical examination. Ngayon po, pag na-detect po ng Bureau of Customs na mayroong illegal na kargamento na pumasok sa Central Mail Exchange Center facility, agad po natin itong kino-coordinate sa PDEA. Once na ma-test po ng PDEA at mag-positive po na ito po ay illegal na droga, magkakandak po ngayon ng operasyon ang PDEA para po sa controlled delivery, the cooperation of other law enforcement agencies in collaboration with them, like, makipag-ugnayan po tayo sa USDEA. Ginagawa po ng Bureau of Customs yun. So yung collaboration po na ito para po sa mas malalim na investigasyon.
Other news, today marks the last day of a two-week joint naval exercise of Filipino and American troops in the Central Luzon region of the Philippines. On Thursday, over 3,000 troops took part in live-fire exercises simulating an assault on a terrorist lair. Bianca Dava gives us the highlights.
At the Colonel Ernesto Ravina Air Base in Capas, Tarlac, personnel of the Philippine Marine Corps and U.S. Marine Corps fire shot after shot. Their target, a terrorist's lair located in the valley. Marines from both sides work together in attacking the target. But it's all part of the Marines Combined Arms Live Fire Exercise, or CALFEX.
The scenario that was conducted was the capture of enemy camps and destruction of enemy forces. The CALFEX is very important since, as we all know, it's a live fire exercise. So we must practice how we execute this live fire to ensure that not only the Philippine Marine Corps forces but also the U.S. Marine Corps forces can conduct these activities safely.
For the Philippines, the exercise meant testing some of its equipment, such as light armored vehicles and 155mm howitzers with their U.S. counterparts. The U.S. Marines also fired at the target using their High Mobility Artillery Rocket System, or HIMARS.
8 rounds of HIMARS. That was followed by approximately 35 minutes of suppression. USMC fired 155s that were then followed on by the Philippine Marine Corps firing their 155s.
When the coast was clear, the Filipino and American Marines moved in to try and breach the enemy line through assault by continuous firing. Attack aircraft also flew in as reinforcements. They provided close air support to the troops on the ground. Major General Charlton Guerlain said the Philippine Marines has already done what was simulated in the exercise in the actual battles against the Abu Sayyaf group and other terrorist groups.
What you witness is always being used in the battlefield, especially during the campaigns in the southern Philippines and also against the communist terrorist groups and also the Abu Sayyaf group. And we have been successful in using all this capability to defeat these threats. The new equipment that we have, we just arrived, that's why we're happy to be able to use it and maybe in future campaigns we can likewise utilize this new capability to defeat the threats confronting the country.
The CALFEX is one of the last drills of the Philippine and U.S. Marines. The joint drills finally occurred after a two-year hiatus because of the COVID-19 pandemic. It also comes at a time of rising tensions between the United States and China. For U.S. officials, the two groups have achieved their goal to successfully exchange tactics and expertise in various areas and to learn to work together as allies.
There's two important things that are happening here. There were particular tactical skill sets that we were working on, the live fire integration with our Philippine Marine partners on the ground was one of them. But more importantly, what you see is the combined strength of two like-minded nations working together toward common cause. It's a very uncertain world that we live in, and I will tell you that there's nowhere better to be standing than arm in arm with our Philippine brothers and showing common purpose in our actions for all to see. The Philippine people have been magnificently represented by their superb armed forces throughout this entire exercise, and it's a real privilege to be here working with them.
To further strengthen its combat and operational capabilities, the Philippine Marine Corps has acquired new assets, including shore-based anti-ship missiles and anti-air missiles, through the Armed Forces Modernization Program. The new assets are expected to arrive next year. Bianca Dava, ABS-CBN News, Capas, Tarlac.
A union of Filipino lawyers urges the Philippine Supreme Court to resolve their petition for protective writs amid red tagging and attacks on their members. Back in 2019, the National Union of People's Lawyers filed a petition for review against the appellate court's ruling, dismissing their plea for a writ of amparo in habeas data. The group claimed their lives were in danger due to alleged red tagging by state security forces. Respondents in the case include then-President Rodrigo Duterte as the Armed Forces Commander-in-Chief and former National Security Advisor Hermógenes Esperón. In a manifestation filed Friday, the lawyers group insists the attacks and red tagging of its members have escalated.
Very reasonable ang hinihingi ng mga lawyers sa Korte Suprema na ikilanlanin ng gobyerno na ang pag-exercise ng profession ng abogado ay hindi dapat subject to attack. Supreme Court should intervene before the attacks not just on lawyers and judges but on the Philippine justice system.
President Marcos not keen on interfering on former Senator Laila de Lima's case following renewed calls to release her. Opposition lawmakers are urging Marcos to use his legal power to end de Lima's detention following Sunday's hostage-taking incident at the PNP custodial center in Camp Crame. But for Marcos, the country's judicial system should be trusted.
I think urging prosecutors to do one thing or another is interfering. So that's why I have said we are very, very clear that we have the three departments of government at siguro naman hindi natin dapat pabayaan natin, hindi naman natin pinagdududahan ang proseso eh.
De Lima, a staunch critic of former President Rodrigo Duterte, has been detained for 5 years now over what human rights groups believe to be fabricated charges meant to silence her. Now, despite the president's recent pronouncement, several American politicians once again urged the Philippine government to release the detained former senator. In a letter addressed to Justice Secretary Remulla, the U.S. lawmaker said Philippine authorities should recognize the lack of evidence against De Lima and drop all charges against her. The lawmakers also cited how De Lima narrowly escaped death at the hand of a knife-wielding hostage taker. The call was spearheaded by Democratic Senator Edward Markey, who visited De Lima in a detention cell in Manila last August. Turning now to the COVID-19 front, an infectious diseases expert reiterates the importance of wearing masks and getting booster shots amid the threat of a new Omicron variant, the XBB subvariant, which has been driving up COVID cases in Singapore recently, is believed to have higher immune evasion ability than the BA.5 strain. Dr. Ronjin Solante says this increases the risk of transmission even among the vaccinated. To date, the health department has not yet detected the XBB sublineage here in the country.
There's a possibility that it can enter the Philippines because our borders are open now. Our first boosted population is really very low. And yet, if you look at Singapore with a high boosted population and yet getting an increase in the number of cases, what if this XBB will be here in the Philippines? And that will really cause a problem in terms of increase in the cases.
The private sector supports the Philippine Health Department's efforts to secure Omicron-specific COVID jabs for the country. The DOH earlier said it is in talks with manufacturers for possible procurement of the vaccines. Go Negosyo founder Joey Concepcion says this is crucial in ensuring additional protection for Filipinos.
We should do that to maintain our wall of immunity. So a healthy economy is also very dependent on a healthy Filipino. No? In other words, kung marami dyan nakakaroon ng infection, siyempre baka may restrict uli ang mobility ng natin, no? Dahil kung talagang uncontrollable at yung hospital utilization natin ay tumaas, no? Dyan nakakatakot. Yung participation ng private sector will be just to pre-register, no? All our employees, no, that will take the vaccines. And we will be committed to that, no? And if they want us to help in the vaccination, we are willing to do that.
The U.S. extends a public health emergency declaration over the COVID-19 pandemic for another 90 days. The extension will preserve measures like high payments to hospitals and expanded health insurance. This comes after President Joe Biden last month said in an interview the pandemic is over, prompting criticism from health experts. Although the toll of the pandemic has diminished significantly, the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention said hundreds of people continue to die from the coronavirus. Biden has also asked Congress for an additional $22.4 billion in funding to prepare for a potential case surge. A major flooding emergency unfolding in Australia as torrential rains hit parts of the country. Thousands were told to evacuate Friday as surging floodwaters threatened towns in three southeastern states. Officials say one person has died while another is missing. Authorities expect the situation to get worse in the coming days. Experts believe climate change is aggravating extreme weather events in the country. Now back here at home, the Philippine government is on weather watch ahead of Tropical Depression Neneng's expected landfall. President Marcos assures residents in the storm's path relief assistance and other government assets are now on standby.
Nakabantay kami ng mabuti, but once again, I think the key to all of this is to watch it very closely because may bagong feature ang mga bagyo ngayon. Yung, kung naalala ninyo, yung Carding was a typhoon signal number one. Within ilang oras lang, naging five na, four, five. Mabilis mag-develop, kaya kailangan nakabantay tayo ng husto. So that's what we are doing. But in terms of relief goods, in terms of material, in terms of assets, we have put them as close as possible to the possible, yung dun sa track na forecast ng ating PAGASA, so that makapasok sila kagad when the time comes. The estimate now is that 10,000 people will be affected.
Several areas in Luzon now under signal number one due to Neneng, which is slightly intensified. It's expected to make landfall or may pass very close in Babuyan Islands or Batanes on Sunday. PAGASA warns Neneng may reach tropical storm category by Saturday evening or Sunday morning. Up next, a business group urges the Marcos administration to address the peso's depreciation against the U.S. dollar. We'll have more news when we return. back with more news. The U.S. and Saudi Arabia trade barbs over the planned oil output cut of OPEC and its allies. Washington accuses Riyadh of knowingly boosting Russian interests as the move seeks to drum up global crude prices in an already tight market. Saudi quickly fired back, saying the statements from the White House are not based on facts, and OPEC's decision was purely taken on economic considerations. The White House again pushed back, saying it presented Saudi with a detailed analysis of how the output cut could hurt the world economy. OPEC and its allies agreed to an oil production cut of 2 million barrels per day starting this November.
Just to review the history here, the Saudis had conveyed to us, both privately as well as publicly, their intention to reduce oil production, which they knew would increase Russian revenues and potentially blunt the effectiveness of sanctions. We made clear that that would be the wrong direction. On that basis alone, the impact that it would have potentially on sanctions, but also because we're in a global economic recovery. The recovery is fragile. We're dealing with headwinds from COVID. We're also dealing with headwinds from the Russian aggression itself.
Tensions between the U.S. and Saudi also casting a pall over the G20's close talks in Washington. The gathering ended without a joint communique from finance ministers and central bankers from the group of 20 major economies. The feud between Washington and Riyadh created new tensions in a group that's already divided over Russia's invasion of Ukraine.
So war, surging commodity prices, as well as the increasing or creating increased global inflation that is followed by the increasing interest rate and tightening liquidity, definitely creating a huge risk for the country which is already in the debt distress. This is not only for the low-income country, but also middle-income country and even advanced countries.
Of course, despite the lack of consensus, officials claim the gathering is still useful.
G20 is an important and truly asset for the global economy, especially for cooperation. This is a premier forum. It was created during the financial crisis. It shows a leadership and response needed. And I think this effectiveness needs to be continued maintained.
The chief of the United Nations nuclear watchdog doubles down on his call to establish a protection zone in Ukraine's Zaporizhia power plant. Rafael Grossi made the remarks as he returned to Kiev after meeting Russian President Vladimir Putin on Wednesday. Grossi is hopeful their negotiations will soon lead to securing the nuclear power plant from the ongoing war in Ukraine.
The idea is that the shelling stops, isn't it? This is why I'm saying very clearly that a protection zone is needed, urgent. There has to be a recognition that this nuclear power plant cannot be a military target of any sort, in any way, intended or unintended.
Former Australian Prime Minister Tony Abbott slams Russian President Vladimir Putin for being what he called a nuclear bully. Speaking at the Asian Conference for Political Communication, Abbott said remarks of dictators should not be ignored. Putin is warned of using Russia's nuclear arsenal in its war against Ukraine.
The challenge is going to be, what does the free world do if Putin uses a so-called tactical nuclear weapon in an attempt to win the war? I hope that decency, at least some shred of it, remains in the Russian dictator or in those around him, and therefore a nuclear weapon is not used. But we can't assume that it won't be, and therefore the free countries and their leaders need to be thinking about what should be done in this gruesome eventuality.
Here at home, a business group urges the Marcos administration to act on the peso's further depreciation against the U.S. dollar. This is as the local currency again plunged to its lowest level against the dollar at 59 Thursday. The peso slightly recovered against the dollar Friday after closing at nearly 58.94.
The depreciation of our currency definitely has a big impact on everything that we import. Especially on related to food staple items. So the government should try to mitigate that in the sense that the supply should be made available. Those we do not produce enough, the importation should be more open.
In an interview, Philippine Central Bank Governor Felipe Medalla hints at another round of a large rate hike of up to 75 basis points. Meanwhile, the Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry says the travel industry can easily absorb workers who may lose their jobs if government shuts down offshore gaming operations. PCCI President George Barcelon points out the travel and leisure sectors are gradually opening up. This comes after a group of POGO workers appealed to government to reconsider plans to shut down the controversial industry, as it would leave 23,000 Filipinos without jobs.
The issue here is really a has to be calibrated, in the sense that if our Bureau of Revenue, together with the law enforcement, can effectively monitor the POGO operators. Tama naman yung sinabi nila na yung mga pwest na na-collect natin, malaking bagay for the country. But we know that somehow the collection is not as ideal. Okay? And the back noises that's happening on the peace and order sort of give us, you know, we don't want to project that image to the world. Now that we're telling the world with the visit of President BBM that we're ready for business, and peace and order is on top of mind.
High inflation coupled with mounting consumer debt seem to take a hit on consumption, which is a key driver of the Philippine economy. ING Bank senior economist Nicolas Mapa says households have been using credit cards and salary loans to get by throughout this pandemic, even borrowing money to pay for daily needs. He notes this may become a problem with interest rates expected to go up further amid elevated inflation.
One of the reasons why VSP tried to keep its handle on interest rates for so long, just to provide them a little more leeway, a little more breathing room. But now I think with what's happening in the world economy, the BSP has to resort to rate hikes. Unfortunately, this will add a challenging environment for households. The silver lining here is that the economy is much better footing than it was in 2021. We have job creation, at least on the uptrend.
There are two more monetary policy rate meetings in the Philippines this year. Mapa sees a total of 100 basis points in hikes happening during those meetings, with the bulk of that possibly happening as early as November. Over 500 brands are offering franchise packages at an event in Pasay City. Let's get more details now from our correspondent, Jackie Pascual, who joins us on the line. Jackie?
Hi, good afternoon, Ron. The Philippine Franchise Association wants to uplift Filipino brands and export it to the world. At the Franchise Asia Philippines Expo in Pasay, PFA Chairman Cheryl Quintana said this is the right time to help Philippine-based brands reach other countries. There are already many Filipino brands overseas, but she said there is still room for more. Over 500 brands are offering franchise packages at the expo, which is dubbed the largest franchise event in Asia. Quintana said 40% of these brands are pandemic brands, or those that were born during the COVID-19 pandemic. These brands have survived and are now open for franchising. The Franchise Expo will run until Sunday, and it offers seminars, trainings, and exhibits for those wanting to start a business through franchising. Aside from local brands, there are also brands from Taiwan, Thailand, Malaysia, and Singapore. These brands are also seeking to expand their presence in the Philippines. And that's the latest. Ron, back to you.
Jackie Pascual with that story. Thanks, Jax. Now, Philippine shares rise in step with global peers even after the release of another hot inflation report from the U.S. Michelle Long with the details.
A surprise eye-popping stock market reversal following higher-than-expected inflation print from the U.S. Global stocks rebounded on Friday, led by Japan's Nikkei 225, which jumped the most since March. Some analysts, though, warn the pop will likely be short-lived, with the grim fundamentals essentially unchanged. Philippine shares, not to be left out, also jumping, with the index adding a 0.1% at 59.04. But for the week, it resumed its decline, now down for a 7th week in 8. First Metro Securities' Aaron Tsai notes the market remains firmly on a downtrend. In fact, the charts are not discounting a return back to 2020 lows, back to 4,000.
If successful, now that bounce can potentially take the PSEI to around the 6.2 to close to 6.4 level, no? Possibly meeting resistance around this 100-day average. And sure, it's just a bounce, which should be followed by another leg down, no? Which could bring the index to lower than 5.7, the recent low. As much as we think that the potential run-up in risk assets, no, equities, are just temporary, I also share the view that the correction downwards now for the prices in commodities prices are just a breather and might move higher moving forward.
In corporate stories, Metrobank shortens the offer period for its 10 billion peso bond offering due to strong demand. It ends October 17th, ahead of the initial schedule of October 19. The bonds have a tenor of 1.5 years and an interest rate of 5% per annum. The bonds are set to be listed on the PDEX on October 28th. This is part of the bank's 200 billion peso bond and commercial program as approved last year. Meanwhile, aircraft maintenance and repair overhaul firm Lufthansa Technique Philippines bullish about the recovery in the aviation industry, predicting a return to pre-COVID 2019 levels by the first half of next year, despite high fuel prices. Lufthansa Technique Stefan Yordanov says they're looking at locations for future growth, the Philippines included. The Philippine unit also looking to go back to its pre-pandemic workforce size of 3,400 people soon from the current 2,600 staff members.
Looking at location size-wise, 5 narrow-body base, that's the next project that we look to host somewhere here in Southeast Asia. Crisis came much faster and much unexpected in terms of strong measures. And this yo-yo is quite symmetrical. The recovery is coming much faster than everyone expected. So there is a strong demand, and I would say that our industry is closer to 95% compared to before.
Lufthansa Technique Philippines is a joint venture between Germany's Lufthansa Technique and Lushotan's Macro Asia. In other news, SAPI's Dan Lachica says new U.S. chip export curbs can also benefit Philippine semiconductors in the long run, as it creates a new source of semiconductor wafers, which are currently dominated by China and Taiwan. Though he says the strong dollar, which used to benefit electronics exporters, no longer yields the same gains.
For every peso devaluation, you would see about a 1 to 1.5% increase in dollar export revenue. However, as you know, there's a lot of factors both globally and nationally that have changed the landscape. The Ukraine-Russia trade war the scarce supply of coal has increased fuel prices. Even local expenses with the inflation and everything, materials, headcount, logistics have increased. So you don't see that upside anymore.
Lachica is confident the industry can stay resilient, and they're keeping their 10% growth target for the year. So far, semicon exports are up 1.6% in the first 8 months of the year, supported by growth in automotive and consumer electronics, as well as data processing. Offsetting these is eroding demand for office equipment. And finally, Premier Horizon Alliance no longer pushing through with its plan to buy 33% of fintech firm SquidPay Technology, which had been valued at 561 million pesos. PHA says the board determined purchasing SquidPay is, quote, no longer in the best interest of the company, given its inability to operate a viable business. PHA adds it will focus instead on its countryside developments, which includes developing properties in Baguio City, Tarlac, and Palawan. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
The National Power Corporation's new president, Martin Rojas, says he wants to stop buying diesel power generation sets for the electrification of remote areas. In a Senate hearing on NAPCOR's proposed 2023 budget, Senator Sherwin Gatalian pointed out NAPCOR's practice of buying diesel power generation sets is now in the billions annually and is costing consumers a lot. All power consumers contribute to missionary electrification through the universal charges in their respective power bills. Rojas, who has only been in office for 2 weeks, says the right way to deal with this problem is through renewable energy. But he admits this will take time.
We should start thinking about decreasing delivering fuel to these far-flung areas because it's an environmental risk. Carrying fuel to small islands, you have to bring it by sea. Right? It's always exposed to theft. So my own agenda is to start looking at ways of minimizing diesel generation, either through hybrids or even using offshore solar and wind in the small islands.
Philippine senators call out the Public Works Department for the supposedly slow progress of repairs in typhoon-hit schools. During the upper chamber's deliberation for the agency's 2023 budget, senators also relayed concerns of defective road constructions. Public Works Chief Manuel Bonoan assures senators they will focus on the repairs and probe reports of contractors using substandard materials for the projects.
One of the marching orders that we have received from the President is to expedite completion of ongoing projects at the earliest possible time. We will be looking at other projects that would really impact to support the economic recovery. For one thing, Your Honor, I think one of the main focus of the department now is to look into the addressing traffic congestion of all the national roads that interconnect regions.
We have more news overseas. Tensions again escalating in the Korean Peninsula. North Korea test-fired a short-range ballistic missile and sent nearly a dozen fighter jets close to its border with the South. That prompted Seoul to scramble its own jets and impose sanctions on several individuals and institutions linked to North Korea. The North's military says its latest actions are in response to a provocative South Korean artillery exercise near the border. North Korean leader Kim Jong-un has supervised a blitz of missile launches in recent weeks, which Pyongyang has described as tactical nuclear drills. The frequency of the North's missile launches has raised concerns. It may be preparing to resume testing of nuclear bombs for the first time since 2017. Five people have been killed in a mass shooting in Raleigh, North Carolina. The fatalities include an off-duty police officer. Two others were injured. Mayor Marianne Baldwin said the shooting occurred near a popular trail in the area. The shooter, a white teenager carrying a long gun, has been arrested. Police have yet to determine his motive. A U.S. jury rejects a death penalty for Nicholas Cruz, a gunman who killed 17 people at his former high school in Parkland, Florida in 2018. Instead, the jury decided that Cruz be sentenced to life in prison without the possibility of parole.
We, the jury, unanimously find that the aggravating factors are sufficient to warrant a possible sentence of death. Yes. One or more individual jurors find that one or more mitigating circumstances was established by the greater weight of the evidence. Yes. We, the jury, unanimously find that the aggravating factors that were proven beyond a reasonable doubt outweigh the mitigating circumstances established. No.
Relatives of the victims shook their heads in disbelief as the verdict was read. Cruz pleaded guilty last year to the Valentine's Day rampage. Still in the U.S., a suspect in the killing of an elderly Filipino man in Los Angeles has been arrested. The L.A. Police Department announced they have arrested a 13-year-old boy that struck store clerk Stephen Reyes during a robbery. The suspect hit Reyes in the head with a scooter. The 68-year-old victim died on the way to the hospital. Police are still on the lookout for three other teenagers involved in that incident. Lawmakers probing the 2021 attack on the U.S. Capitol vote to subpoena former President Donald Trump so he can testify on his role in the violence. During what was expected to be its final hearing before the midterm elections, the lawmakers unanimously agreed to compel Trump's appearance. The move marks an aggressive escalation of the probe, which has issued more than 100 other subpoenas and interviewed more than 1,000 people since 2021.
We are obligated to seek answers directly from the man who set this all in motion. And every American is entitled to those answers so we can act now to protect our republic. So this afternoon, I am offering this resolution that the committee direct the chairman to issue a subpoena for relevant documents and testimony under oath from Donald John Trump in connection with the January 6th attack on the United States Capitol.
He is the one person at the center of the story of what happened on January 6th. So we want to hear from him. The committee needs to do everything in our power to tell the most complete story possible and provide recommendations to help ensure nothing like January 6th ever happens again. We need to be fair and thorough and gain a full context for the evidence we've obtained.
On a social media platform, Trump called the committee a failure that has only served to further divide the country. The frontrunner to become the next premier of the Canadian province of British Columbia is seeking the support of Filipino community leaders. Rowena Papasin has the details.
It's an honor to work with her. Thank you, Mabel.
Former BC Attorney General David Eby has gone to different Filipino events since declaring his bid to be the next leader of the New Democratic Party, or the NDP. His party mate, Filipino-Canadian lawmaker Mabel Elmore, has openly endorsed Eby and introduced him to a gathering of Filipino community leaders at the Philippine Consulate General in Vancouver. BC Premier John Horgan is stepping down as the party leader, and whoever replaces him will also become the next premier of the province.
So he's got my support. He's an inspiration. He's dedicated to the people. He has a heart of public service. We're together. I'm asking the Filipino community to engage, get involved, be part of our government, who works on behalf of people.
Eby, a human rights lawyer and former head of the BC Civil Liberties Association, thanked Elmore for her support. He also assured the Filipino community that Elmore will play a key role in government if he is chosen to succeed Horgan.
Mabel is a remarkable community leader. I've seen her work for many years in government, and she'll be working very closely with me if I'm successful for my bid as premier. Because I know that she has such a close connection with the Filipino-Canadian community, and that's a voice that we need to have in government advocating.
Eby was also endorsed by former Labor leader Bonnie Barcia, who hosted a party to introduce him to Filipino NDP members. Barcia is close to many NDP leaders, including Horgan and Health Minister Adrian Dix, and said Filipinos will get more government support if Eby wins the race for party leadership.
Under the David Eby's leadership, I know that there will be more money for healthcare, more job security for workers, and that's a big deal. because, as you know, most of the Filipino people here in British Columbia work in the healthcare sector.
Meantime, EB also hailed the participation of more Filipino Canadians in BC's municipal elections.
I was really excited to see four really strong candidates who will be the first Filipino Canadians elected to their city councils if they're successful. We're seeing more and more Filipino Canadians stepping up in British Columbia to run and to represent their communities and government, and I'm thrilled to see it.
With the municipal elections just around the corner, Filipino candidates for council seats have doubled down on their campaign efforts. Barcia urged Kababayans to support the Filipino bets as he stressed that city councils will have the most impact in their everyday lives.
Once they become member of the council, they can push for more housing project to help our Kababayan and other stuff. It's nice to have some voice within the council.
Advance voting has already started and the last day to vote is on Saturday, October 15. Results will be known shortly after the poll closes. Rowena Papasin, ABS-CBN News, Vancouver.
Switching gears now, Jamie Lee Curtis reprises her most famous role in the final installment of the Halloween film series. The actress spoke with our correspondent Yong Chavez about what her character has represented since it was introduced over four decades ago.
Laurie Strode, the character that Jamie Lee Curtis first played in 1978, takes her last stand in the epic and bloody conclusion of the Halloween film series. The veteran actress has given everything she has in the role that made her an all-time favorite among horror fans. Curtis shared how her character did something in Halloween Ends that she's never done before.
How would you describe your first day on set in the first movie 44 years ago versus your first day on this one?
I had been an actor for about a year prior to that, so I knew what it was like to be around a crew. A really good character day for me to get comfortable with Laurie as a character. And the first day on this last one, the Laurie we meet at the beginning of the movie has had a little bit of help. She's had a little bit of mental health support. She's had some grief counseling. And there is the possibility of a little bit of hope. Not ever healing. You can't heal from the death of a child, but that you can live with the death. First day here, it was a scene of hope. So it was so strange to me because I've been playing Laurie for so long that when I finished the scene, my face hurt and I couldn't figure out why. And I realized it was because I was smiling. And Laurie Strode had never smiled.
The actress says that like many women who have told her over the years, she is also inspired by her character's resilience and instinct for survival.
Really summarizes why you're the ultimate hero in horror franchise. How did you get to be so fearless in your career and in your life?
That fearlessness is because Laurie Strode is fearless. And what I like to say is that every woman I know is fearless. We have all survived all sorts of things. Women from the beginning of time have been persecuted, have been hurt, have had violence perpetrated upon them, and we have persevered. And I am simply a representation of that. And Laurie Strode is the ultimate representation of that.
The movie, directed by David Gordon Green, also stars James Jude Courtney as Michael Myers, Andy Matichak, and Kyle Richards. Yong Chavez, ABS-CBN News, here in Hollywood.
Let's now find out what our resident movie critic Manny the Movie Guy thinks of Halloween Ends and another new horror film. Take a look.
She gave it all. Her heart, her soul, her blood.
Welcome back, Laurie Strode.
And welcome back, Jamie Lee Curtis, who gave it all, her heart, her soul, her blood, to play the Scream Queen we all love. Laurie Strode.
It's a movie about a final reckoning between Laurie and Michael.
This is the third and supposedly final chapter of the Halloween H40 trilogy that began in 2018 from writer-director David Gordon Green.
There is no rhyme or reason.
Set 4 years after the last Halloween Kills, Laurie is trying to move on, living with her granddaughter Allison, and our boogeyman Michael Myers is nowhere to be seen. But you know, he'll be back. Gordon Green and company keep the excitement up by limiting Michael Myers' appearance, igniting our imagination. And I also like that this particular trilogy examines trauma and how it affects the mindset of a community.
You pretend like you moved on, but you're actually just obsessed with death.
Violent and brutal, with the obligatory showdown between Laurie and Michael, this is a Halloween movie perfect for fans. But is this the end? Not even Jamie Lee Curtis can kill this monster franchise. And for that, Halloween Ends gets 3 out of 4 in theaters and on Peacock, kisses. And on Netflix, there's The Curse of Bridge Hollow.
I've done so many raunchy, crazy horror comedies. You know, it was just nice to do one that I could actually watch with my children.
Marlon Wayans, purveyor of horror comedies like A Haunted House and the Scary Movie franchise, returns in the entertaining but predictable The Curse of Bridge Hollow.
My dad's a science teacher.
What makes this different from all the other Wayans scary comedies is the charming nature of the story. There's a delightful father and daughter dynamics here, with Priya Ferguson playing Wayans' baby girl who accidentally releases an ancient spirit.
This flesh has got a lot cooler.
Funny and sweet, with a little bit of spine-tingling action, stream The Curse of Bridge Hollow now on Netflix.
This one you can enjoy spending time with your entire family.
And for that, The Curse of Bridge Hollow gets 2.5 out of 4. It's Cursed Kisses. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ABS-CBN News.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thank you for watching. Now, quick roundup of news you need to know. Philippine Justice Secretary Boying Remulla faces growing calls for resignation following the arrest of his son over drug possession. But President Bongbong Marcos says the calls have no basis. The Philippine government bracing for the landfall of Tropical Depression Nining. A business group calls on the Marcos administration to address the peso's further depreciation against the U.S. dollar. And the world war between the U.S. and Saudi Arabia escalates over the planned oil output cut of OPEC and its allies. Those are the headlines. Keep it here on ANC.